It's going to be an absolutely gorgeous day today, but it's a good thing to be in the house of the Lord. Let's ask God's blessing as we look to His Word. Father, thank You so much. We know that You send Your Word with Your Holy Spirit, and You send it in power, and that You would transform us, that You'll give us the principles on which we can build our lives. So God, this morning we open our heart to receive from Your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. The title of our message this morning is The School of Adversity, as we look now at the life of Joseph. Joseph was Jacob's favorite son. The reason why he was the favorite son was because he was the firstborn of Rachel. Rachel was the woman that he fell in love with when he went to Haran, you know, seeking a wife. And he made no qualms about the fact that he was his favorite. In fact, you're not supposed to have favorites, but he just made it very clear that he was his favorite. He even made him this special variegated, you know, colorful coat and gave it to him, which made him stand out. And Joseph, when he became an adult, he had these two dreams. And these are very significant. And the interpretation did not require a lot of insight because it was straightforward. His first dream was that his sheaf, you know, a bundle of wheat being harvested, stood upright while the sheaves of his brothers bowed down to it. Well, that's pretty obvious. The dream is saying that the brothers are going to come under his authority at some point. Then he had another dream that the moon and the sun and the 11 stars bowed down before him. So now the brothers again are bowing down. Even his father is going to recognize his authority. Well, it would be fair to say that the rest of the family didn't exactly interpret Joseph's dream with the same excitement that Joseph did. In fact, he became angry and jealous of him. In fact, at one point, Jacob sent Joseph out to check on his older brothers, who were quite some distance away. They were tending the flock. And they saw him coming from some distance. And they said, "Here comes that dreamer. Let's take him. In fact, let's kill him. And then let's see what comes of his dreams." Well, Reuben, who was the firstborn, discouraged this. And he said, no, let's not kill him. Let's put him into a cistern, a dry well. And then let's let him just die on his own in there, which doesn't sound very nice at first. But his secret plan was to come back later and rescue him and bring him back to his father. Well, while Reuben was gone, the rest of the brothers, after seizing him and putting him into the cistern, they saw some Ishmaelite traders coming, Midianites. And so they said, "We should just sell him. Let's make some profit from this. Why should we have blood on our hands, you know?" And so they sold him as a slave for 20 shekels of silver. Jesus was betrayed for 30, by the way. And so he was sold as a slave, taken down to Egypt, where he was then sold again. And he was purchased by a man named Potiphar, who was an officer in Pharaoh's court. And there, the hand of the Lord was on Joseph. And soon he was overseeing Potiphar's estate, overseeing all that he owned. But again, once again, tragedy struck in his life as he was falsely accused by Potiphar's wife and thrown into prison. And that's where we pick up our story. You know, Joseph is one of the great men of the Old Testament. I don't know about you, but I have some of the favorites. And Joseph's one of my favorites. He's just a pillar of faith, of steadfastness, of integrity. There's so many lessons from Joseph's life. And this is important because everybody in this room has walked through difficult times. And therefore, we need principles that will guide us in difficult times, because there are still yet more difficulties in front of us. We need principles. We need God's help in order to understand how to stand firm with integrity in the midst of troubles. And that's what we learn from Joseph. Let's read his story. We're picking this up on chapter 39, verse 19. And again, we put all the other verses together at the Wednesday service. So come and be part of that. We love our Wednesday service. Starting 39, verse 19. It came about that when his master, that'd be Potiphar, heard the words of his wife, which she spoke to him saying, "This is what that slave did to me," then his anger burned. And this is a false accusation. So Joseph's master took him and put him into the jail, the place where the king's prisoners were confined, and he was there in the jail. But the Lord was with Joseph and extended kindness to him. Now, this to me is such an amazing aspect of this story, because here, so many things seem to be against Joseph. So much adversity, so much difficulty, and yet we read over and over this kind of verse. The Lord is with Joseph, extended kindness to him, gave him favor in the sight of the chief jailer, and the chief jailer committed to Joseph's charge all the prisoners who were in the jail, so that whatever was done there, he was responsible for it. The chief jailer did not supervise anything under Joseph's charge, because he trusted him, in other words. The Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it to prosper. Chapter 40, verse 1. Then it came about after these things that the cupbearer and the baker for the king of Egypt offended their lord, the king of Egypt. And Pharaoh, that's the king, was furious with his two officials, the chief cupbearer and the chief baker. So he put them in confinement in the house of the captain of the bodyguard in the jail, the same place where Joseph was imprisoned. And the captain of the bodyguard put Joseph in charge of them. And he took care of them, and they were in confinement for some time. They were there quite some time. Then the cupbearer and the baker for the king of Egypt, who were confined in the jail, they both had a dream the same night, each man with his own dream, and each dream with its own interpretation. When Joseph came to them in the morning and observed them, behold, they were dejected. And he asked Pharaoh's officials, who were with him in confinement in his master's house, "Why are your faces so sad today?" And then they said to him, "We have had this dream, and there is no one to interpret it." They understood it was important, significant, but they had no one to interpret it. So then Joseph said to them, "Do not interpretations belong to God? Tell it to me, please." And of course, then we know he interprets these dreams, and it comes about then that through the course of time, that these are worked by God to the effect that he, of course, is set out of prison and then established as the man of great authority in Egypt. Now, that's a very important part of the story. Again, we'll weave all the other verses together on Wednesday. I want us to look at these, though, because of the lessons for our own lives. We need lessons. We need those principles that will guide us, because difficult times will come upon all of us. So let's begin with this one. We see it in Joseph's life. Hold on to your integrity. In the midst of troubles, you hold on to your integrity. Joseph, he could have decided that because life had given him a bad turn, might as well quit. Many people do that. They throw up their hands. Everything's against me. And they want to quit. He could have said in his heart, "Well, if this is the way you're going to treat me, Lord, then I'm giving up trusting in you. I quit my faith." Many people do that. They blame God. But Joseph, he's a tremendous example of holding fast to his integrity and holding fast to his faith. You think about examples of people who've suffered greatly, and I think Job, obviously, has got to stand out. But he stands out as a supreme example of suffering, yet being strong in his integrity. In fact, at one point, it was so bad, it got to the point where his wife challenged him and said, "Do you still hold on to your integrity? Curse God and die, man." So Job responds to this. "You speak like one of the foolish women. Shall we indeed..." See, here's the principle. He understands this. "Shall we indeed accept good from God and not adversity?" In all of this, Job held on to his integrity. Joseph is like that. He holds on to his integrity. And we see that exemplified in this. Don't repay evil for evil. See, Joseph could have spent the rest of his life plotting revenge. "If I ever have the opportunity, I will get my revenge on those brothers." Some might even suggest that's the right thing to do. I mean, after all, the betrayal of the brothers deserved revenge. But see, that's a principle of the world. See, the principles of the world are distinctly different than the principles of the kingdom of God. You're in the kingdom of God now, and there's a whole different set of principles that apply. See, in the world, the principles of the world are like this. Hey, if you're going to cuss at me, then I should be able to cuss at you. I mean, after all, it's only fair. If you're going to be mean-spirited to me, then I ought to get to be mean-spirited to you. After all, it's only fair. If you're going to plot evil against me, then I get to plot evil against you. After all, it's only fair. See, but that's a worldly principle. It's not a godly one. We're in the kingdom of God now, and a whole different set of principles apply. The right thing to do is to walk in faith, trusting that God is able to bring about justice. God settles all accounts. That's faith. God settles all accounts. Romans chapter 12, verses 19 to 21. Never take your own revenge. This is the principle of the kingdom. Never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God, which is to say, God settles accounts. It is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. So here's the principle of the kingdom now that will guide us. If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If your enemy is thirsty, give him a drink. For in so doing, you heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Now, many of you know our story, that we've been through tragedy when our daughter was killed 4 years ago, and the trial for her murderer was just last summer. But at that trial, after the jury had found him guilty of aggravated murder, sentenced him to life without the possibility of parole, I asked the DA, district attorney, if I could request to speak with him personally there in the courtroom. And so he made the request. Her father would like to ask permission of the court to speak. So she said, come forward. So I came and I said, I would like to speak to him personally. And she said, you're not allowed to have a conversation with him. I said, I don't want him to speak to me. I want him to listen to me. And she said, do it. So I turned around and he was as close as like here to the front row. It's an opportunity. Opportunity for what? Opportunity to speak words of bitterness, of harshness, revenge. Many would have seized on that opportunity. But no, the principles of the kingdom are different. So I said to him, Jaime, listen to me. Look at me. I'm concerned for your soul. Do you not understand that there is a judge who is much higher than the judge that you stand before today? There's a judge over all the earth. And one day you're going to stand before that judge and give an account of your soul. Now is the time to change. I offer you forgiveness. Take this forgiveness as an opportunity to redeem now that which God gives to you. Stop hurting people. Oh, he had hurt so many people. Take this as an opportunity to change your life, because you will stand before the judge of all the earth. When my wife then, she wanted to come, so she came and she spoke. And she said, Jaime, I pray for you every day. Every day I pray for you. I pray for your soul. I pray that you would find God in your life. You see, the principles of God bring peace. Now, many people suffer, perhaps not to that degree, but there are many other examples. I remember many years ago, there was a dispute between some members of my wife's side of the family, and we were asked to choose sides. Well, we didn't want to choose sides. We didn't want to get involved in this. And so we said, we're not going to choose sides. And well, in that case, you will be ostracized also. And we were. Until cancer struck the family. And then our response was, you can't stop us from loving you. We are going to pour out our love. I'll tell you something, love wins. Amen? Love wins. Jacob kept walking in integrity and he kept looking. See, this is the key. You walk in integrity and then you keep looking for the hand of God to move in your life. You keep looking for the hand of God to move. Psalm 121, verses 1 to 2. I will lift up mine eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, maker of heaven and earth. See, I love that verse. If God, by his power, is maker of heaven and earth, then God, by his power, is able to help in time of need. Here's another one, Psalm 25. My eyes are continually toward the Lord, for he will pluck my feet out of the net. The troubles of my heart are enlarged. Bring me out of my distresses, Lord. Guard my soul. Deliver me. Do not let me be ashamed, for I take refuge in you. Let integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you. Oh, redeem Israel, O God, out of all of his troubles. Great, great verses to strengthen us in our faith. And then we see this principle that comes out of that. Don't allow your heart to be bitter. If bitterness had entered Joseph's heart, I tell you, it would have stood in the way of what God was doing. God was doing something through all of this. And if bitterness had taken hold of him, it would have been in the way. This is an important lesson for all of us. It would have prevented him from seeing the blessing of God in his life. Don't let bitterness and anger come into your life against God. Don't let bitterness or anger come into your heart against other people. Bitterness and anger stand in the way. Many people ask after our daughter was healed, are you angry with God? No, I'm not. I've never been angry with God. Why should I be angry? He is the one who brought forgiveness to our daughter. He's the one who held her and received her to himself. He's the one that's going to bring us together someday in heaven. And so there's an important principle. In Potiphar's house, he was faithful to God. He was faithful to the task at hand, and God was with him. The blessing of God follows. Look at Genesis chapter 39. It just says that very thing. The Lord was with Joseph. So he became a successful man. And he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. It came about that from the time he made Joseph overseer in his house and over all that he owned, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house on account of Joseph. Thus, the Lord's blessing was upon all that he owned in the house and in the field. Later, when he found himself falsely accused and thrown into prison, here again, he didn't allow himself to become bitter with God then either. It's like one tragedy after the other, but he won't allow his heart to be bitter. When things happen that are completely unjust, many people can relate to this. Things happen in life that are completely unjust. It would be easy to allow bitterness to enter your heart, but that never brings anything good. The scripture describes the effect of bitterness as like a bitter root that enters into a well that makes all of the water in the well bitter. Now, see, you can see that picture in your life. If bitterness creeps into your life like a bitter root, it will make all of the soul bitter. Everything in your life then will be affected by that bitterness. It is a poisoning effect. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. See to it. Make sure of it, that no one comes short of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springing up causes trouble, and by it many are defiled. What a picture for us. It's a poisoning effect on all the life. That's why Paul wrote, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 31 to 32, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, and along with malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other just as God in Christ has forgiven you. This is a principle of the kingdom of God, forgiveness. Forgive those who've hurt you. Forgive those who've offended you. Too many people, they hold on and they hold on and they hold on to their offenses and it becomes a root of bitterness. Let go of this. When I think about my mom, many of you know, of course, our story. that my mom was suffered greatly in life. She suffered particularly under the hand of my father. Now, my father's story is amazing in that he came to Christ when he was 75, baptized in myself. Many of you know this story. But my mom, what an example of suffering. All those years she suffered. Then later, he divorced her, moved away to Arkansas. And many of you know the story. When he was 75, my older brother died. So he came up for the funeral, and it was an opportunity to begin to restore. He came to church, came to faith in Jesus Christ. As I said, baptized him. I moved him into the same apartment complex that my mom lived in, and she started being a friend. She started reaching out to him, being a friend to him. She cared for him. Though they never remarried, they became friends, and they were friends the rest of their lives. And I will never forget that when he died, and when we had the memorial service, there was my mom. We had an open casket service, and at the end of the service, she, when people were to come forward, you know, and pay their last respects, she went up first, and she stood at the head of the casket. And as people came, it's like they were a couple. And whenever they would come and pay their respects to him, then she would like shake their hand or hug them and thank you so much. And I'm sitting over there kind of on the side watching all of this, amazed at such grace. And then after everyone had left, I just wanted to see what was going to happen. I just stood off to the side. After everyone had left, she came around to the front of the coffin. She leaned in and kissed him. And she said, I love you, Cecil. I tell you, so touching. Grace. Grace is such a powerful principle. And then you see, because it's combined with what's happening in Joseph's life. See, here's a principle that comes right through this. Don't doubt in the darkness. Don't doubt in the darkness. My Bible that I use was a gift many years ago from a couple that helped us start the church. And on the inside back cover, they wrote a little saying, never doubt in the darkness what God has shown you in the light. I love that principle. Because it's faith, isn't it? In Genesis 29, we find Joseph in his darkest hour, but we see that in spite of everything that's going against him, he never doubts. He never doubts in the darkness. He believes. See, because here's the substance of that God is working in your behalf. That is the substance. So that's why you do not doubt in the darkness. You believe in all faith that God is working in your behalf. See, Joseph could have focused on what was all wrong in his life. It would have been easy to wrongly interpret all of that. Many people, they do this running commentary on their lives, trying to figure out what God is doing and why. Some things are impossible to understand until the end. But faith trusts that God knows what he's doing, that there's a plan that God puts all together. See, many years later, we know the story that when his brothers came to Egypt, you know, in search of food because of a severe famine, there was Joseph. Now risen to a place of authority, he was there to provide for them. Not only did he provide for them, but he was kind to them. And he spoke a tremendous, powerful word in Genesis 45, jumping ahead in the story. Genesis 45, he said to his brothers, God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant in the earth and to keep you alive for a great deliverance. Therefore, it was not you who sent me here, but God. That is amazing right there. That is amazing. He could see the sovereign hand of God. Now he could see it. Genesis 50, verse 20, he says it this way. You meant it for evil. Let's be clear. You meant it for evil. But God, he meant it for good. God can use all things. See, many people fall into the false notion that when things are going well, that's the confirmation that God is with them. That's all fine and good. But what they do then is that they reverse that also when things are difficult, when obstacles come. They're convinced that God is against them. When things are difficult, it does not mean that God is against you. It means that God is working somehow through these things. Strong faith believes that God is true to his word, that he causes all things to work together, Romans 8:28. We know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. God was working for Joseph, even in prison, even arranging for who he would be caring for, the chief baker and the chief cupbearer, opportunity to hear their dreams. Joseph kept his heart before God, and God blessed it, even while he was suffering unjustly. This is why. This is what happened. Because there's a principle in the kingdom, and it's a good principle for all of us to understand, because there will be troubles in life. And it's this: strengthen yourself in the Lord. This is what is such a key to us. What if Joseph decided, you know, to wallow in his self-pity? What if he decided to walk away from his faith? Would the chief jailer have promoted him? No. You can see that Joseph kept his heart on the Lord, because when the chief cupbearer and the baker, you know, were placed in his care, he turned them toward God. Do not interpretations belong to God? Tell them to me, please. You know, when they mentioned their dreams, Joseph could have said instead, dreams? Don't talk to me about dreams. I've had enough of dreams. I'll hear nothing of your dreams. No, points them to the Lord. They belong to God. One of the most important things we can ever do in difficult times is to be strengthened in the Lord. Proverbs 18:10. Right, I mentioned it before. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it and are saved. You keep looking for the Lord. You keep looking for the hand of God. I remember a number of years ago, I was in the business world, and I was CEO of a company, and we were rapidly growing, but we needed God's help. We got into a place where we needed God's help. And so I said, Lord, you and you alone can save. I need your help. So I decided what I was going to do was to pray and fast. But I didn't know how long that God was going to be in answering this prayer. So I decided that I would do not a complete fast, because, you know, you can die after a number of days. So I decided I would do a Daniel fast. You know what Daniel's fast is, right? So when Daniel fasted, and he ate only the healthiest foods, right? Grains and vegetables, right? And so I decided I'm going to do Daniel fast. I'm going to pray every day. I'm going to do Daniel's fast. So that means I like no sugar, no junk food, no Doritos, no ding dongs, not even Diet Coke. I mean, I'm just going to be in a place of praying, and I'm going to use Daniel's fast to remind me all day long to keep praying. So in the morning, God, I need your help. I'm asking today. I will fast today for your help. The next morning, God, I need your help. I will fast today as I seek after you. I need your help. Next day, God, I will fast today as I am seeking after you. I need your help. Next day, I did this for 18 months. And I tell you, God amazingly answered. Amazingly, miraculously answered. See, this is an important part of the story, because many people are impatient. They don't want to wait. Look at the patience of Joseph. Years and years went by. You see this principle. His faith kept being strengthened. David is an example. When David came back from the camp after he and his men had been gone all day, they discovered that the Amalekites had come and burned the camp and taken everything, including the wives and children. There was such a general outrage that they began to speak of stoning David. But here's where we learn a great key for all of us. 1 Samuel verse 30, verse 6, underline this principle. David was greatly distressed because the people spoke of stoning him, for all the people were embittered, each one because of his sons and daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord, he and he alone, because he was a leader. What a principle, like Isaiah 40. One of the famous verses in the Bible that speaks to this. Isaiah 40, do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired. His understanding is inscrutable. He gives strength to the weary. And to him who lacks might, he increases power. The youths grow weary and tired, and vigorous young men stumble badly. Yet those who wait for the Lord, it is they who will gain strength. Those who wait for the Lord, they will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired, and they will walk and not faint. And here's the principle as we close with this, that God will change you through the fire. You wait because God is doing something in you. God will change you through the fire. If we're strengthened in the Lord through difficulties, we are strengthened. God can use those things to transform us. Like James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials. That doesn't mean when a trial comes in your life, you say, woo, let's throw a party, more trials. No, he's speaking about a joy that comes because of faith. When you have a residing faith, it brings a residing joy. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result so that you may be perfect, complete, lacking in nothing. You know, there's a hymn that we love to sing in the church. And the story of that hymn really is a powerful illustration of the point. It's the song, It Is Well With My Soul. And it was written by a Chicago lawyer, actually. His name was Horatio Spafford. Now, you might think a rich, successful Chicago lawyer might indeed write a song entitled It Is Well With My Soul. But the words speak of a different part of this life. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, you have taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul. It wasn't written during a joyful period. On the contrary, it came from a man who suffered almost unimaginable tragedy. He and his wife, Anna, were well known in the 1860s of Chicago, not only because of his successful legal career and successful business endeavors. They were prominent supporters and close friends of D.L. Moody, famous Chicago preacher and evangelist. But in 1870, things turned tragically in his life. They had one son. They had four daughters, one son. And that one son died of scarlet fever at the age of four. Then 1 year later, the famous Chicago fire swept through Chicago, and Horatio had invested heavily in the real estate of the shores of Lake Michigan, and the fire of 1871, every single one of his buildings was destroyed by the fire, wiped out. And then aware of the toll that these disasters were taking on his family, Horatio decided that to take his wife and remaining four daughters on a holiday in England. Not only did they need the rest, but D.L. Moody needed the help. He was traveling through Britain on an evangelistic campaign. So they planned to join Moody in England in late 1873. So they traveled to New York in late October. From there, they were to catch a French ship, steamer, the Villa de Havre, to cross over the Atlantic. Just before they were to set sail, then he got word that there was a last-minute trouble with his businesses, and he was forced to delay. But not wanting to ruin the family holiday, he persuaded his family to go on ahead and that he would follow later. With this decided, Anna and the four daughters sailed east toward Europe. Spafford returned west to Chicago. 9 days later, Spafford received word that the ship carrying his wife and four daughters had perished at sea. November 2nd, 1873, the Villa de Havre collided with the La Kern, an English vessel, sank in 12 minutes, claiming the lives of 226 people. Anna had stood bravely on the deck with her daughters, Annie and Maggie and Bessie and Tanetta. They were clinging desperately to their mother. Her last memory was that of having her baby torn violently from her arms by the force of the waters. She herself was only saved by a plank which floated beneath her unconscious body and propped her up. When the survivors of the wreck had been rescued, Mrs. Stafford's first reaction was complete despair. But a voice began to speak to her heart. You were spared for a purpose. She immediately recalled the words of a friend. It's easy to be grateful when you have much, but take care that you are not a fair-weather friend of God. Spafford then received a telegram from his wife. I mean, she was in Wales, and this telegram read simply, saved, alone. Upon hearing the news, Spafford boarded the next ship out of New York to join his bereaved wife. During the voyage, the captain of the ship called him to the bridge. A careful reckoning has been made, he said, and I believe we are now at the place where the Havre was perished. The water is 3 miles deep. With a broken heart, he stood out on the deck, watching the waves. He then returned to his cabin and penned the hymn, It Is Well With My Soul. It would be difficult for any of us to predict how we would react under similar circumstances, but we know that God who sustained him is the God who will sustain us. No matter what circumstances overtake us, may we be able to say, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the grace by which we can say, it is well with my soul. Father, I pray for everyone in this room today. Everyone who is here, Lord, understands that life has tragedies. And I pray for everyone in this room that each one would say in their heart, no matter what comes in my life, no matter what tragedy befalls, I trust you, God, with my soul. May I say, may I declare it is well with my soul. Father, we thank you so much for your grace on our lives, for your hand upon us. We give you that now as we trust in you. In Jesus' name.